Hello, and welcome back to my course on learning commands in Minecraft. My name is slicedlime, and in this one, we're going to expand on how we change blocks using commands. First, we've already learned the basics of the setblock command. There's another option to it that we haven't talked about yet though, the mode. The mode is an argument placed after the setblock commands we've used this far. It is one of three options: replace, keep, or destroy. Replace works exactly the way we've learned this far. It is the default option and simply replaces whatever was there before with our new block. Keep prefers keeping what was already there, only setting the block if the space previously contained an error block. And finally, destroy will cause the previous block in that location to drop as if it had been mined, or destroyed by some other means like a TNT explosion. Another thing we should talk about is aspects of blocks. This far, we've been setting things like gold blocks that always look the same, but this is not the case for all blocks. Let's take something like a simple oak log as an example. Slash setblock tilde tilde negative 1 tilde oak log sets an oak log beneath our feet. Remember the relative coordinates from the previous video. Note how the log points upwards. This is the default state of a log, and in fact of all such blocks that can be placed along any axis. Let's say that we really wanted to set that log horizontally though, how would we do that? This is where something called block states come in. A block state represents a combination of properties that a block can have. This can be anything from the orientation of a log to the orientations a wall or fence is connected, or whether a redstone lamp is lit. To use a block state, we'll type a left square bracket after the ID of the block. This is read open square bracket, just like a left parenthesis is read open parenthesis. Setblock tilde tilde negative 1 tilde oak log open square bracket. Now we can see the game suggests how the block state for the log can be modified. In this case, our only option is the axis option. So let's type axis equals. You can see we have the option of any of the three axes here. Let's do x and then close the state with a right square bracket. Note how the log is now horizontal. And if we switch the debug screen on, we can verify that the log is now aligned with the red axis at the center of the screen. If you need to specify more than one state property for the same block, you list them all within the same square brackets, separated with commas. As we talked about last time, the Minecraft Wiki is a great resource when it comes to finding out what the details are for an entity. This also goes for blocks. Let's look at a more complex block, the diorite wall. Let's go to the wall wiki page. Just like last time, we're looking for the data value section, but this time it's the block states subsection. Here we can see all the different possible property names and the values they accept. So we could, for instance, say that the wall is connected to the west and east with low segments and that it is waterlogged. You can also see the state of any block directly in the game by activating the debug menu, the F3 screen. Aim at any block and check out the right-hand side of the screen. There you'll see information about the block you're aiming at, including its position and block state. Another way to play with block states is a special item in the game called the Debug Stick. This item only exists in creative mode and through the use of commands, specifically the give command. Slash give slicedlime debug stick gives me one. I can use this on any block in the world to cycle through the different block states on it. Left-clicking on a block selects one of its properties, and right-clicking cycles through the possible values for that property. If the block you're pointing at has a normal interaction, you might need to sneak to use the debug stick on it. There's more to certain types of complex blocks as well, but before we get into that, let me take a quick moment to ask you to cycle the clicked state on the like button for the video. Liking the video helps spread it further on YouTube, so I do appreciate it. Block states cover the most common block variations in the game, but not quite all. You'll only find block states for data where it's possible to enumerate all possible combinations of the block's state. For other data, like blocks with inventories, or other such complex data, the game creates something called block entities. Block entities have data in a format often called NBT data. Strictly speaking, NBT is the format this data is stored as on disk, but the name is prevalent enough to learn even if it is slightly incorrect. Block entity data is entered after a block ID and any possible states in curly brackets. If you've ever worked with a JSON syntax, block entity data will seem familiar to you, as the format is pretty similar. If you haven't, don't worry. There will be plenty of time and opportunities to practice. This type of data can be incredibly complex and is in general different for every type of block entity and entity in the game, so don't expect to ever learn all of it by heart. The good news is that it's also entirely unnecessary to learn it all by heart. Many block entities store items in one way or another. This is true for anything from pure containers like chests to special blocks like lecterns or jukeboxes. Others store other things, like the rows of text on signs or the patterns on a banner. Once again, the wiki comes to our rescue with full descriptions of the possible block entity data for a block type, although don't stare too much at it. At this point, much of this information will probably seem incomprehensible, hard to read, and with many unknown terms. For now, it's important to understand that block entities exist, and that they store more complex types of data about blocks in the game. We'll have plenty of opportunities to look at the details later on. Once again, there's also a way to inspect block entity data directly within the game. This time, there's far too much data to display it all on the F3 screen though. Instead, there is another debug command, triggered by aiming at a block, holding down F3, and pressing I. This will copy all the block entity data for that block into the clipboard. In fact, it will do so in the form of a Setblock command, also including its position, ID, and block states. You can paste this into the chat to look at it. Although, for complex blocks, this data can even end up longer than the amount of text you're allowed to type on the chat input. For those cases, try pasting the command into a command block. Of course, you could also just paste the command outside the game, like in a text editor, to be able to more easily get an overview. One more thing about block entities. You might hear them referred to as tile entities. That is simply an older word for the same thing, still used by some parts of the community. A large part of making effective command functionality, be it in custom maps or data packs, is learning to effectively read and manipulate this type of data. We're just scratching the surface of it here, and we'll be returning to it many times over the rest of the series. But for now, we'll leave it there. Thank you for learning Minecraft commands with me, and remember to get the companion map and run through the exercises there.